After a short hiatus due to travel and working on my latest app, Swift News is back. And we got a lot to talk about because WWDC just happened. I timed that nicely, didn't I? But before we dive into all the WWDC goodness, quick reminders, all my iOS dev courses are currently on sale for 30% off during the WWDC sale, but that ends tomorrow, Tuesday. And don't forget to sign up for the Swift News newsletter. The link will be in the description to get Swift News in your inbox every Monday. Let's kick things off with a short recap of the highlights of WWDC, and I'll give you my opinion on some things. First and foremost, obviously, the liquid glass update. I'm a fan. I think it's pretty sick looking, and not just because it's glass. It's like alive. It's fluid. It's interactive. It's crazy the level of detail that Apple went into on this. I mean, look at how the colors bend with the glass, and the glass reflects the environment, like items and icons next to the glass subtly reflect off of it. Again, the level of detail is insane. This is not just a frosted glass UI. I'm a huge fan and am pumped to work on this over the summer and build it into my apps. And another thing I love about it is that it's unified across all the Apple platforms, like iOS, iPadOS, macOS, watchOS, visionOS. It's all the same design language, which is really great if you're building a multi-platform app in SwiftUI. And the last thing I'll mention on this is I've long been a huge proponent of just using the built-in system stuff, like tab view, pickers, controls, all the built-in stuff that SwiftUI or UIKit gives you out of the box. Because if you did that, well, you get this liquid glass update pretty much for free. Whereas if you went through and built all kinds of custom components, you're gonna have a lot of work to do to adopt this new style. To me, the next biggest highlight was the foundation models. This is a framework that gives us access to Apple's on-device LLMs that Apple Intelligence uses. Now, will these models be as good and as powerful as the third-party server-based models? Of course not. But there's some key trade-offs to consider here. Like I said, it's on device, so you don't have to go out to the internet to use it. You can use it offline. It's also private. It's a first-party framework, so you don't have to worry about a third-party account, API keys, where now you got to secure those API keys so no other evil developers steal it and use it, or you don't got to worry about users running up your AI bill. And a nice little thing is you can mark your types generable, so the LLM will know to use your Swift types in the response, making it much easier to develop with. So yes, while it won't be as powerful as those third-party server-based LLMs, there are a lot of advantages to using the foundation models. And you gotta remember, we're developers, we're always online on Twitter seeing the latest and greatest on how people are pushing these LLMs. 99% of the population, they just have a very simple problem that a nice simple AI implementation that the foundation models are perfectly capable of can solve their problem or make your app way better. So I recommend learning everything you can about this foundation model framework and brainstorming how you can implement it into your app to improve it. All right, I don't want to get carried away. I can't sit here and talk about everything right now. I mean, I probably will eventually have videos for all of this, but let me touch on a few other highlights before we move on. Along with this liquid glass design, we're getting new app icons, and these app icons are universal across all the platforms. And you don't have to be some crazy awesome designer to design a glass-like app icon. That's where Icon Composer comes in. You just put in your flat designs, and then this Icon Composer tool makes it all glassy and translucent and ready to go for the new iOS 26, macOS 26, whatever you're on. Xcode finally gets Swift Assist, which is a nice sidebar AI companion you can chat to. It has all the context of your code base in Swift. I haven't had a chance to try that out yet because it requires macOS Tahoe 26, and I'm just not ready to do that on my machine just yet in beta 1. I also think this new Playgrounds macro is gonna be an unsung hero. It's basically Swift Playgrounds built right into Xcode within this macro in a little preview window. So you can test out, see what the logic of your code does right there in this macro, and then get rid of it if you're done testing it out. SF Symbols got this new draw effect when you're adding or removing it from a view. You can also use it during the magic replace. Again, SF Symbols just keep getting more and more powerful. If you're not using them, like, I don't know what you're doing. And of course, there's so much more. I'll put a link in the description to the list of 100 plus WWDC sessions. Enjoy watching them over the rest of your summer. So obviously the liquid glass redesign is a huge deal. It's what everyone's talking about. But I want to point out to you that Apple's Human Interface Guidelines, or the HIG for short, have been updated with new guidelines for liquid glass. And if you're unfamiliar with the HIG, it's basically Apple's guidelines on how to build UI like Apple. And they tell you exactly all the best practices on how to use each little element. So we'll visit the human interface guidelines that have been updated for liquid glass. For example, color, you think that's pretty foundational. However, they recommend, you know, when you're using liquid glass in the color to use it sparingly, right? It says right here, use color sparingly in liquid glass, right? Don't make all your buttons in your navigation title a color, Save that for the primary action button. Use it sparingly. And you may not know that if you didn't look at Apple's human interface guidelines. We'll give a couple more examples. These new toolbars with liquid glass, each is its own little element, it talks about the spacing, how you should use that. They give an example with a standard layout right here on the toolbar, and then you can also see what it should look like in compact, how more options should be in a disclosure button. Again, that's just a small little example, but every little thing you can think of, you know, search fields that are now on the bottom, it'll tell you how to do that. It'll give you considerations when using generative AI. Just again, Apple is guiding you with best practices on how to make an awesome app for the Apple ecosystem. Many of you are probably already familiar with the HIG. I recommend reading through it at least once a year, especially when a huge, huge change has just come through, like liquid glass. Everyone's gonna have to learn how to implement this properly. Next up, Apple unveils winners and finalists of the 2025 Apple Design Awards. And I share this article every year with the same message every year. Go download these apps and use it for inspiration. For example, the Delight and Fun category, CapWords. Go download CapWords, play with it, go through their onboarding, see how they do their interactions, animations, right? Because this is the Delight and Fun category. But don't just download the winner. You can see there's, I don't know if that's a runner-up, then here's like other finalists you can go download. There's the innovation category with Play. You may have seen Play on the channel. They've been a sponsor a few times. Great product. You can keep scrolling through all the categories, but again, the point remains, go download some of these apps and play with them and start pulling in ideas from these award winners on how you can improve your app. Moving on, there's been a pretty big change to the App Store optimization algorithm when it comes to keywords. And we got Ariel from AppFigures here on the case. The biggest App Store algorithm changes here. This is what you need to know. He breaks it down, but TLDR, Apple is now extracting text from your App Store screenshots and treating that as part of your keyword metadata. And he discovered all this through reverse engineering. He has so much data on the AppFigures platform, but essentially I'll go to a picture here just to really illustrate it. You know, make it easy for the OCR to pull out your text and read it. You don't want this light text on there. Have a lot of contrast so it's easy to read, and then use keyword-like words on here. Don't just say like fast, easy, fun. Say fast photo editing. Put your keywords in your App Store screenshots is the TLDR, but if you want more details, go ahead and read this article from Ariel. He was on the case fast, and here's what he found. Next up, we have Stop Overthinking AI Subscriptions from Peter Steinberger. And the gist of this article is the productivity gains increase drastically dwarf the cost of the AI. He goes through some different tests he ran with some different models and plans, but the point remains, I'll just go down to the TLDR, because yeah, if you're working for a company and maybe building hobby apps on the side, not trying to make money, sure, $200 a month for some of these Max Pro plans, probably a lot. But if you're trying to make money from your own apps, or you're a contractor, or it's just, the math is insane. These are just an absolute no-brainer good deal. I can speak from the indie dev perspective, it is like having a full-time junior developer employee for 200 bucks a month. Like, that is an insanely good deal. And I'll finish off with his TLDR here. Time is the only non-fillable resource. Claude Max at $200 is currently the cheapest way I know to mint extra hours, and those hours compound faster than any SaaS line item ever will. Basically, yes, there's some sticker shock. These are a little bit expensive on the surface, but man, it's insane value. And lastly, a quick one, swift.org got a nice little redesign. I'll refresh it so you can see the intro animation. That's it, just a cool, fun, modern redesign. One little thing that's interesting is like the iOS app's use case description is kind of minimal and low. I guess that's because it's like the default obvious choice everyone knows about. Most people coming to this website maybe are interested in like cloud services, command line, embedded, because it's just obvious and known iOS apps. But I thought that was interesting that like iOS apps was kind of like a secondary item on the landing page. But anyway, cool new design. That wraps it up for this week's episode of Swift News. Don't forget to sign up for the newsletter. Link is in the description. We'll see you in the next one.